Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Come to order, and Ms. Vaughn has the invocation tonight.
Well, I'm going to take the pleasure of introducing Reverend Isley. She's a member of the Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, the Democratic Women of Alamance, the NAACP, the ABRSP, which is retired school personnel, and Women in Ministry of the Western North Carolina Conference of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. She is presently the pastor of St. James African Methodist Episcopal Church in Oak Ridge, North Carolina. She firmly believes that everybody is somebody and Christ is all. Reverend Isley.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, it is in the name of Jesus that we enter into your presence this evening, realizing that this is a county commissioner's meeting, but yet and still we realize that we need your presence in the midst. It is our prayer, O God, that you will touch each person that is present and that you will remember those that are not able to be here. Remember the things that are happening in our world and touch those that are being affected by many, many ways of destruction in our area and far away. We thank you for the snow that has already fallen, but we also thank you for allowing us the opportunity to be here tonight. We pray that you will give our board the wisdom and the patience to listen to the public as they bring their feelings and their information forward. Give them the understanding that they need to make the right decisions that will positively affect Alamance County and its citizens. We thank you now for all things, and we trust you to move in the behalf of the citizens of Alamance County. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
We don't have any public comments tonight, so we will move on to the public hearings at this time. And Mr. Burgess, if you will take over.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. Of course, we have a public hearing on our Group B projects for the facility improvement plan and the borrowing financing of those projects. Tonight I have, to answer any questions that you may have about these projects, I have Stuart Keeler, our purchasing director for Alamance County, Evolution Routon and Charles Nicholson, the architects with R&D, are here with us tonight. They'll be glad to answer any questions that you may have. As you recall, going back a while back on July 7, 2008, the board authorized the county to proceed with renovations and repairs to numerous county facilities. On September 2, 2008, the board approved the contract with Routon, Nicholson, and DeLuca for the architectural work for those projects. On August 3, 2009, the board approved the Group A projects, which are underway now. And on January the 19th of this year, the board set a public hearing tonight for the purpose of receiving public comments on the proposed financing method for the Group B projects. In your agenda packets, you have several documents. I just want to, in addition to the memo that I provided, you have Exhibit A, which is the resolution that I'll talk about later. You have Exhibit B, which is the recommendation letters for awarding contracts on the projects and also the bid tabulations for each of the projects. Exhibit C is the LGC resolution that we'll talk about a little bit. And then the last document that you have in there is a proposal from RBC Bank for the financing for this project. So those are some documents that we'll address tonight. You also have a spreadsheet in there. It's both attached to Exhibit A, but you have a larger version that I put in there for you that's a little bit easier to see than the other one. I want to highlight some of the items on there. I have a similar spreadsheet on the overhead up here that I'm going to highlight some of the items on there. We've got nine projects that we're getting to work on Group B, if the board approves them tonight. The first one is the Human Services Center, which is repairing the exterior wall to what's known as the same-day surgery wing. The old same-day surgery ring, the total cost of that project is $117,136.05. That does include the construction contracted amount, contingency, and then other fees such as the design fees and some other reimbursables for the architect and then for some owner's reserve costs there also. The next project is courthouse renovations. I'll get into that a little bit later as to details of that one. That one's $3,017,303.53. the county office building toilet renovations, which is downstairs. On the first floor, we're renovating both the men's and women's restrooms so that they'll be ADA compliant. That project is $89,901.80. Cedar Rock Park, we are constructing restrooms, a maintenance facility there, and also repairing one of the historic buildings that there that I'm trying to shore it in and dry it in and repairing it. So that project is $503,229. The next one is repair renovations and ADA work. That really encompasses three projects. The ramp over at the Sheriff's Department is being replaced. If you notice that, it's in disrepair. The Environmental Services Building, we're replacing the windows in that building, also replacing the gutters and the downspouts at that building. And then over at the MIS Training Center that's over on the HSC property, we're addressing some drainage issues over there. So those projects total $266,483.64.
Before you leave that screen, I thought at Cedar Rock we were going to be at $150,000.
No, sir. I don't recall us being at a...
that's the figure that came out of the meeting that y'all had out there.
We did reduce some of the projects. I don't remember a number figure being...
Was that Cedar Rock or was that...
Cedar Rock.
Eli Whitney.
I apologize.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's fine.
I apologize.
Yeah, Eli Whitney, what we're looking at is a budget on that of no more than $100,000.
Yeah, Eli, I apologize. Okay.
So anyway, those three projects at repair renovations, and all this detail is listed on your spreadsheet there. Mm-hmm. The remaining projects, the agricultural building, we're looking at some HVAC upgrades, $26,248.28. Roofing bundle, part B1. Let me talk about that a little bit. We took bids on that. We did not receive enough bids as per statute, so we're having to rebid that project. We're supposed to open the bids this Thursday. We've put a budget estimate in there. Once we open those bids on Thursday, then we'll bring those back to your next meeting for you to approve the contract. So if it is less than this budgeted amount here, then we will use that either for additional contingency on this project or just a contingency for the entire project. So that's what we'll do there. Total estimated cost, you can see there, is $783,800.45. Roofing bundle part B2 involves several of our facilities there. I think it's register of deeds, central permitting. I think there was one more that we're working on there as far as the roofing bundle group B2. And then the paving bundle. We are paving the rest of our parking lots, basically. That's $918,489.75. The parking lots that we're paving is the one across the street, Sheriff's Department and the County Office Building parking, criminal courts, which is on the other side of that. We're also paving elderly services, which is located, the environmental services and agricultural building we're repaving. Also doing the road that goes through Cedar Rock Park and the new Family Justice Center Fire Marshal's office, we're paving that one. Where the fire marshal is currently located at HSC, we'll be paving that parking lot also. If you'll notice, we did put an additional, once these bids came in under where we had anticipated, we did put some additional money in here to look at the possibility of repaving Board of Elections and the Register of Deeds parking lot also. So we did put some additional money in there. Total cost here, $5,900,000. When you take and add that to the $3.5 million that was the Group A projects, that gives us a total of $9,400,000. We were shooting to come under $10 million, so we came under that by $600,000. So we feel like we did a very good, the architects and everybody involved did a very good job trying to keep the cost of the projects down. I want to highlight one other thing on this chart here also. With the courthouse renovation here, we did put in an additional $200,000 once the bids came in and they were lower than what we anticipated. Originally, we had not planned on doing any work on the first floor as you come in. We're looking into remodeling those offices on the first floor and doing some painting work on the entry level there. I do want to talk a minute about the courthouse renovation. This is one of our bigger ones, and just kind of give you an overview of what's going to be done there. All of the windows in the building, exterior windows in the building, will be replaced. All of the exterior doors will be replaced. Starting at the top level, there are two offices on this end which will be renovated. The courtroom will experience an entire renovation there. Ceiling will be replaced, floor coverings will be replaced, all the seating in there will be replaced. The woodwork will be redone, the judge's bench will be redone, the balcony area, the seats that are in the balcony will be refurbished up there. So all of that will be done in the courtroom area. As you get down to the first floor, all of those four offices will be renovated. There'll be painting done on the first floor level. As you get into the basement, we've had some water issues down there. That will be dried in. There's a file room downstairs that will be renovated. There's a hearing room downstairs that will be renovated where the clerk of court holds hearings, and also small claims court has hearings there too. There's a men and women's restrooms downstairs that will be renovated. And then there will be some work done in the hallway out there also as far as painting and stuff like that. Exterior wise, there will be a ramp put on the north side of the building. On the northeast side of the building, a ramp will be installed on the outside. The outside of the building, it'll be pointed anywhere where the mortars come loose or the mortars in bad shape. All of that will be pointed. As I mentioned earlier, the exterior doors will be replaced. The light fixtures, as you notice at the bottom of the steps on the side of the building, there's 8 light fixtures. Those will be refurbished. Landscaping will be done on the outside. The irrigation system will be put in to keep the grass and the landscaping living.
Have I missed anything, Charles?
I think I remember everything. And if there's anything else in there, that's just a bonus. So that's what we're looking at going to the courthouse.
Will the courthouse, forgive me, yes. Will the courthouse, you had, and I definitely remember this conversation, there were some comments about the balcony wasn't stable enough to withstand use. Right. Is that going to be usable at this point?
Yes, that will be addressed. So the balcony will be used. We're going to, the existing seating in there.
Is that back to the original? Seating about the original?
Okay. We're keeping that seating, having all of those refurbished, except we're removing the back row so that we can use those parts to refurbish those seats, and then we're going to put new benches on the very back row of the balcony, so it will be usable at that time. So. Again, prices came in at, we budgeted $5.9 million. Again, that overall cost to both Group A and Group B, $9.4 million. We do look at all of these Group B projects being completed in about a year. Early 2011 is when those should be completed. We look at getting these projects started sometime around May 1st, at the latest, probably getting them kicked off. The longest time lead probably on any of the projects will be the courthouse. That's about a 9 to 10 month project. Somewhere in there, so we'll be looking at. So a year from now, hopefully we'll be through with all of these Group A and Group B projects is our goal. Now, how are we going to pay for this? We're looking at actually using federal stimulus program funds through RBC Bank. If you look at Exhibit C, that will give you the details of that. And then also the proposal, financing proposal from RBC, it gives you all of the details of that information. Let me hit some of the highlights real quickly. Part of the bonds that we're going to use is from the Recovery Zone Economic Development Bonds Program. We'll be using $3 million from that, 10-year repayment period. The normal interest rate on that was 5.41%. Because it was part of the federal stimulus program, they'll actually be paying 45% of the interest payment. So therefore, in effect, it reduces the interest rate down to 2.9755%. So that's a very good interest rate. In the initial year, the yearly payments on that debt will be $387,033.38. Because it's a fixed principal, but a interest rate is, or the interest amount is based on your outstanding balance over time, the amount of those payments will decrease. The second group will be using $2.9 million from the Build America Bonds Program, 10-year repayment period, interest rate. Normal interest rate, 5.41%. The effective rate is 3.5165%. That's because the federal government will be paying 35% of the interest payments on that. So it gave us an effective rate of that below 3.5%. The yearly payments in the first year on that will be $389,429.04 for a total in the first year of, for Group B, of $776,462.42. And that's all in the documentation that's been provided for you from RBC Bank. A couple of things that we need. If you have any questions on the project, be glad to discuss those. The spreadsheet we gave you explains that in great detail. The items that we need you to approve tonight, there are two resolutions or two different documents that contain resolutions. The first one is Exhibit A. This document here, which is the first resolution. Basically what that does is, first thing it does is authorize financing for the project. The second thing, it awards a construction contract subject to LGC approval and receipt of the loan proceeds. And these projects that we're looking at you approving are listed on the spreadsheet you've got. Plus, in Exhibit B, it does give you all of the recommendations from the architect, and it also gives you the bid tabulation showing you who actually submitted bids and who the lowest bidders were.
The first year of 776, is
that's
that?
Group
B?
Yes, sir, that's Group B.
$776,000, is that?
$462.42.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
2010-2011 budget or 11-12?
Well, the first payment is due right now, based on our schedule now, is due September the 19th of 2010, and that's about $194,000. That's the first payment on the recovery zone economic development, which is $3 million. The first payment's due 9/19/2010, $194,632.50. The second payment under that $3 million loan or $3 million financing is March the 19th of 2011. March 19th of 2011. So that would all fall within next year's budget.
That's correct.
So all of that would.
All right. Now, what about Group A?
We have one half of the payment is in the current year budget. The second half of it will be budgeted in next year's budget. So you're going to have one half of Group A, and then you'll have all of Group B.
Okay. Can we get a pro forma or a sheet showing A, B? And
I can give it to you. I've got it right here.
When they're due. And
well, yeah, we could get that to you. I've got the totals right here, but I don't have the.
Yeah, I'd like to see that just for.
Yeah, and also for the Group B, I think the proposal from RBC, if I'm not mistaken, I think it has the breakdown. It's got
it
payment schedule
on the back
right
schedule.
Right.
And that's where?
That's in
the one RBC.
It's in the RBC one. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Send this one. Thing.
Is that A and B?
That's just B. And right. We can get a Group A payment schedule.
If you would.
It is on the back.
Can. Okay.
I'm
glad to do that.
Last sheet.
We'll be glad to get that to you. And then the third thing that resolution basically does, and some other information there, but it also gives county manager authority to execute documents and use his discretion and make modifications when executing the construction contracts and the finance agreement. So that's what Exhibit A, the first resolution, does. There's a second document in there, which is Exhibit C. This is the LGC resolution. There's really two resolutions contained within that one document. On page one is the first resolution. Let me just read the heading on that, and that kind of tells you what this resolution is for. It says, Resolution of the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina, declaring its intention to reimburse said county from the proceeds of one or more tax-exempt financings for certain expenditures in connection with various projects. So that is the first resolution that we'll be asking you to adopt. The second resolution begins on page four of that same document. Mm-hmm. And that one is entitled Resolution Making Certain Determinations Concerning a Proposed Installment Financing Agreement to Finance a Portion of the Cost of Various Projects and Providing for Certain Related Matters. So those are the two resolutions. So tonight we would ask you to adopt all three of those resolutions tonight so that we can move forward with these projects. And at this time, we'll be glad to take any questions that you may have about these projects or the financing or anything else.
I think I have to open it to the public for coming as well.
Before we do anything.
So I think at this time I will open it to the public for public comments. If anybody's got any comments on it, that's what I mean. This is a public hearing. Well, no, we don't have anybody that wants to speak on it, so anybody up here got any questions?
No, I would ask if you don't mind, though. I see what we've got on Group B as far as the money flow.
Yes, sir.
Can you take A and B and put it together?
Yes, sir. I've got that for you.
When you would. Well,
you need that number now?
Not now, no. Okay. I just want to be able to see it because, you know, we're getting ready to get into the budget. Negotiations here, and I want to have it clear. You're showing it to us, but it's a lot of numbers here, and I'd like to see a little more.
We'll be glad to give you what the total debt payment yearly is on Group A and the total yearly debt payment on Group B. And
right.
Give you a total dollar.
Right.
And what they just mentioned as well, there hopefully is a reallocation of funding from the recovery zone. Again, we're going to split it up right now where our full allocation, but we get a better interest rate if we can use all recovery zone funding. We should know by this time next week if we got that allocation. So if we do get that full allocation, that we don't have to use Build America bonds as well, that will save us some more money on our debt service as well.
So do I just need to close this public hearing at this time?
At this time, I will close this public hearing. We have no more comments, and I will entertain a motion.
Now, do we need to do these separately or all this one?
That would be fine. Probably so.
Okay.
The first one we'd ask you.
First one would be Exhibit A.
Exhibit A, the resolution.
Do I hear a motion? We adopt Exhibit A.
I'll make that motion.
Have a motion on the floor and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, no opposed. And the next is Exhibit C.
We'll probably want to break the next one down into two since it is two separate resolutions.
Okay.
And the first one begins again on Exhibit C on page
right.
one is the beginning of that part of the resolution.
Okay, do I hear a motion that we accept part one of Exhibit C?
Yeah.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
And then the second part of Exhibit C
is on page four.
On page four, do I hear a motion that we accept this resolution?
I make that motion.
Have a motion to accept the resolution on page four.
Second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate your support for all of these projects. So.
Okay.
Hopefully one day we'll be doing them.
She did.
Okay. The next thing I will open the public hearing for, which is part 4B, the Career and Technical Center bonds.
Would you like me to?
I would.
Okay.
You told me I didn't have to read all this.
No, that's fine.
I've read it, but.
not a problem. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I'll go over this very quickly. This is the Qualified School Construction Bond Program that we have been working on with Alamance Burlington School System for the $7.2 million Career Tech Center. Funding will come from $4.99 million, which is the QSCAP bonds, which is part of the stimulus funding as well. The interest rate will not exceed 2.5% on this. The debt service on this for 15 years will be $457,000 approximately. The county's portion will be $130,000. And again, these are funds that we have saved with respect to the refinancing that we did back in late or early fall.
Is that per year?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. For 15 years is the 457. Years. The additional $327,000 or remaining will come from the school's lottery proceeds. And then any cash that is needed to complete the project that is above the $4.99 million will come from their lottery proceeds.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions from the public on this public hearing? Because this is another public hearing.
What's the, just for sake of information, what's the net amount of lottery proceeds that will be available after all that's done to put into classrooms?
I think they'll have a balance of 1.2.
It's about 1.8, I think.
Or 1.8
they just
million.
Drew down a lot right. for the land, but I think the balance is about 1.8.
Right.
That's for this fiscal year.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what does it look like for next year?
Is
lottery proceeds down?
Not really.
I think they're running about where budgeted.
Yeah.
The governor did institute the funding back.
So yes, she did.
About 1.8 million available each year to move into building.
Yes, sir.
Capital needs.
Yes, sir.
That's good.
Okay. If I don't have any questions from the public at this point, I will close the public hearing and. Do I hear a motion that we accept this resolution of the Board of Commissioners for this project?
Second.
And motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right. Moving right along. Mebane grant application. Mr. Martin, if you will come forward on that.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have laid in front of you a series of maps. There's two maps there of these proposed districts, and I'll be very brief. The city of Mebane approached the county to participate in a grant application to prepare a study and a nomination for the National Register of Historic Places for the Old South Mebane Historic District and the Mebane Commercial Historic District. And these are there along Washington Street, and just a kind of put things in perspective, it's literally right across from City Hall in Mebane. where they have all the commercial there and also the housing behind City Hall and over about five blocks between 5th and 1st Street.
Is that going to take, that's not going to take the cemetery in, is it?
I don't believe.
I mean, I know where it is. I just don't see it out here. So we evidently don't go that far.
Okay. I don't recall seeing that. But these have been on the study list, which is the precursor to preparing an application for the National Register. The city pursued that in 2000 and then also in 2006. The county, being a certified local government, can apply for grant funding to assist with preparing those nominations. Mm-hmm. And the city of Mebane, actually, I just received confirmation that they have approved the match funds for this particular grant, which there's a 40% match with that of $11,052. So there is no county funds attached to this at all. Okay. The county would be applying for $16,578. With your approval tonight, we will move forward with that and get that application in by the end of next week.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. Martin on this? If not, I'll entertain a motion for this.
I'll make a motion that we move forward with it.
Okay.
Second.
Any second on the
table?
Aye. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you.
Okay, the hazardous mitigation plan.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I'll make this brief also. As you recall, 2 weeks ago we came in and presented the hazardous mitigation plan to you. The steps are to basically tonight is to satisfy that second public hearing that the state requires for any public hearing, any comments on it. Basically what we're going to do at this point, we will take the rough draft and we will submit it to Raleigh. Between now and probably August, our office, we will go back and forth with them, fine-tuning it, finding out anything that they suggest that we need to add to our plan. Kind of like I said 2 weeks ago, you know, we've got a good workable plan. We believe we do. We know we do because, you know, we had it in 05. We'll go back and forth with the state on this thing, and once we get it all finalized, we will bring it back to your review for final approval, and at that time, we will send it back to Raleigh. You're looking at probably around the 1st of September. Our goal in our office is to get this plan to them sometime this month. And the biggest difference with the plan versus in 05 was in 05 we had three plans. We had the county, we had the city of Graham, and we had the city of Burlington. This time it will be all in one plan, one umbrella plan. And that's really the goal here. Like I said, we're kind of open now for any kind of, if anybody has any comments on it. We're kind of at a point now where we've got to, the next step is to get it to Raleigh.
Have the municipalities already signed on to it?
Yes, sir. Graham came on back in August, I believe. And Burlington, in fact, I think we're going to address that tonight, like David is, with the resolution.
Right.
Burlington has come on board with it. And it's just a matter now of getting it together and sending this draft to them. And like I said, our office, we're expecting some back and forth on it. But hopefully we'll get it fine-tuned and we'll get it to them. And once it's approved, it'll stand for 5 years unless we have a major disaster or whatever here in the county, like an ice storm, a flood. A hurricane comes through. At that time, we will take it in. Yeah. Of course, our office, we're going to review it annually anyway, because FEMA pretty much suggests us to review it annually. And then after that 5 years, it's not so much dumped on you at one time. Where if we go through it annually, we'll know kind of where maybe our weak points are or whatever. Hopefully, we won't have any weak points.
Okay.
That's about all I have, unless somebody else has.
Do we have any questions? This is a public hearing as well. So if anybody's got any questions. Okay. If not, we will move
Thank
on
y'all.
To close the public hearing. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, the next thing is the county manager report.
Okay, thank you, Madam Chairperson. At our last meeting, there was a concern from the public as well as from the board about requiring e-verification to be added to contractors and contracts that we have. Again, as we talked about, that was a concern that the board had under the Group A projects. We did not have anything approved, so therefore it was not required. However, in Group B, using federal funds, using under the Davis-Bacon Act, it is required, but we do need to add something to our contracts that will kind of cover us for other contracts that are not just federally funded contracts. So with the board's permission and working with our county attorney, we would like to suggest that any new contracts we have with contractors that do work for Alamance County, that we add the following paragraph. The parties hereby stipulate that the contractor shall use the E-Verify system established and maintained by the United States Department of Homeland Security to ensure that all contractor and subcontractor employees meet the employment eligibility requirements as set forth in the federal laws, rules, and regulations, and further that the contractor and subcontractor shall maintain E-Verify records and make them immediately available upon the written request of Alamance County. And with the board,
so he's going to monitor. Do you have him asking to monitor that, or
it, the thought process at this time is that we add this on the contracts, and then unless there's a problem, unless there's a concern by either the public or there's a concern by staff or concern by the board, then we would ask the contractors to do the E-Verify and give us that verification. We did not want to turn this into an administrative nightmare, you know, to have to keep up with every contract, but only if there was a problem, an issue, or concern, we wanted to have the opportunity to check on that.
Okay. Any more questions here?
Well, yeah, that's the biggest question, is how do you monitor that? Because what you have is contractors running the job, and then you have subcontractors working under them, and then they're subbing out to subs. And, right. And the trickle-down effect of that is a nightmare in itself to figure out who's who. Are there any penalties for using illegals?
The thought process that we had, if they didn't follow the guidelines of our contract, that we would have the option in the future not to use them.
Okay.
You know, I think that would probably, especially for local contractors, that may be a big enough stick out there that, you know, they would then disqualify themselves from being considered a valid vendor for county business.
But a lot of our contractors that we're seeing coming through here now for these projects are not local. Is there any way that we can penalize people that comes to our attention? And I know it'd be a nightmare to, you know, check everybody, but can we check, can we penalize them money-wise? I mean, something that's going to hurt if they don't use E-Verify. If you have this in the contract and we find out about it.
Yeah. It's a similar issue that you have with performance bonds and workers' compensation insurance. You generally find out about it when someone gets hurt or a bond claim is made. Whether they have the required insurance or not, unfortunately, that's the way it works. The penalty, the ultimate penalty, is having the Homeland Security Department find out that they're hiring and using illegal aliens. The Homeland Security will take what action that they'll take at that point. But I think before, if I was a contractor, before I signed this, I would make sure that my subs were all.
So we've not had this in any of our contracts previous.
No, this is brand new. Yeah.
It's just like a security bond, a performance bond, or workers' compensation insurance. Every contract has it. And I mean, I guess we could pull every contract and call them and say, give us a certificate and make sure it's paid up or have it
dying.
Generally, we rely on reputable contractors.
Now, who's going to sign this contract? Besides the contractor, who's going to sign it?
This would be part of the contract. So, any contract that is signed either by the manager or commission chairperson.
Okay.
You know, just kind of be an addendum to the contract.
So, we'll know who it is basically all down the line, even their subs, right?
Well, if he's got a sub on the job and gets injured, that's probably why we would find out.
Okay.
I will be very honest with you. This is something unique and something that I'm not aware that other counties are doing. and there probably will be some bugs that we have to work out as we go through the process. Okay. It may not be smooth to begin with, but this will give us a starting place so that we can move forward and meet the wishes of the board.
Okay. Federal contractors are already using this.
Well, the state, I mean, it's not so new in that it's unapproachable. I mean, the state's doing it.
Right.
I can't swear to the date, but I know that we discussed E-Verify at length, privately and publicly. And it's hard to, forgive me, but it's hard for two people to tell me they dropped the ball on getting this in the Group A projects if they didn't, if it wasn't there to be put in there. I mean, you can't drop the ball if you're never handed the ball. And I believe that we definitely said, okay, we can't force contractors in the county due to the way we do business and put out the permits and so forth. We can't allow, we can't force them to have E-Verify, it appears, but we can definitely do it for anybody that does work for the county. And that's what we agreed on. And I can't tell you the date. I think Kim says it was back in September. Okay, so I do want to see that DVD. I assume we have that meeting. But it's, and again, I've, you know, hit many areas of this debate, not just E-Verify, but anything that pertains to illegal immigration. And in the best of my memory, over in Guilford County, they actually go out and spot check work sites, if I'm not mistaken. And I don't know what they do when they get out there. But I'll charge here that we haven't done enough homework to make this as foolproof as possible. Not saying I don't think we ought to go ahead and sign this tonight or approve this tonight, but I think there's more homework to be done, and it's nothing to be just knee-jerk reaction to my complaints or anybody else on the board or somebody from the public. I mean, there's other people doing this, and they're doing it probably more efficiently and with more determination than we are, and I don't know where, you know, I'm not, y'all, no offense, y'all were paid the big bucks to check these things out. And
well, this simply sets forth that the county can write a letter to the contractor and say, give me E-Verify records for all your employees and all your subcontractors.
And they have to make sure they understand that.
And they have to send it to you.
And I would spot check it. I mean, I would go in and do a quality.
I think you're right.
Go in and do a quality control spot check, just like you do of anything else in business.
You could send a letter with their second or third draw on their contract. Give us your E-Verify record.
Well, I know as a contractor, before I put a sub on the job, they're going to at least have their workman's comp and all that paperwork to me. And maybe you need to spot check some subs that are sent, putting people out, to make sure they understand too when they bid that job for the GC.
Let me forgive me, Henry. You're in farming. Does the government come out for migrant workers and check records, or check with farmers what legal work that, you know, what legal?
And it depends on, you know, which workman you're using, because, you know, like the H-2A workers have to be approved and come through the whole program, and so that's under a different guideline. It said. They come in on a 9 month visa and then return, you know. So that's under a different guidelines. But E-Verify has been promoted, you know, with farmers that use labor regardless of where it comes from. You know, for the, you know, H-2A is already approved. But if you hire somebody on your farm, they have promoted, you know, used this E-Verify. The thing about, and I think Clyde will tell you on the E-Verify, is that you can't E-Verify just one group of people. Each one of those employees that you do has to be E-Verified, whether they're a citizen or not. And whether or not you participate or not is your choice. And I think that's what we need to push, is that each employer that we contract use the E-Verify, because, and ask them, do you use E-Verify? And if you don't use E-Verify, then we want you to be able to qualify for our contracts.
That's what this says.
This is written for an addendum to existing agreements. You could make that part of your bid package if that's a requirement.
I would think it would need to be. I mean, so that people
that takes care of that issue. And this takes care of the back issue where you've already got contracts. and you ask them to sign. They're already out there working.
Who draws up our contracts?
I review them, but most of them are drawn up by the architects.
They're standard architectural offices.
And they're about every clause you can imagine in there. But this would take care of the ones that we've already done, the addendum, and then we put it in the bid package for the future contract.
I think one conversation we had about E-Verify, Ms. Hook was going to, you're going to do E-Verify out of your office for county hires, is that correct? How hard was it to get set up on?
It was actually set up before I came in, so I can't tell you.
Have you used it yet?
Oh, we use it all the time.
Use it on me?
For every employee.
How's it work? Without belaboring the issue, how does it work?
A potential employee comes in, they give you a certain amount of paperwork, you enter it into the computer, and it will tell you immediately if they are a U.S. citizen or eligible to work in the United States. We have not had any that were flagged, so I haven't been through the process of what you do if it comes back a flagged employee.
What's the time, from the time you enter it to the time you get your reply back?
It's, I mean, less than a day. Most of the time it's pretty immediate. But, I mean, we've had to wait up to a day before.
Would a contractor or a subcontractor have to have special equipment to do this?
A computer. Just a computer.
Mm-hmm. And they would have to go in and register themselves. I don't think it would take them long to do that.
Plug in your federal ID number mm-hmm. and you're set up.
Kim, you got any points you want to make on that? Anything you want to add or take away? Or?
I just hope that it's overlooked well, you know, it's regulated well. To where spot check can be done. I mean, we've got a federal holding facility right across the street over here, and if people try to manipulate the system, I think they need to be held accountable. There's a lot of it going on, a lot of false documents floating around and such.
Okay, any more questions up here? If not, do I hear a motion we accept this addendum?
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next.
I have a couple of things if I could. Barry Bass is here tonight. He would like to make a request for a couple of out-of-state travel requests. They did not meet our agenda deadline, but they need to be next week. So, Barry, if you wanted to make that.
Thank you for your indulgence. But I have two particular items related back to our WIC program. And our WIC director has been invited by our state director of WIC directors to attend a leadership conference in Washington, D.C., representing Alamance County in North Carolina. And it's a leadership conference, and it's a good opportunity for us to be able to have recognition for Alamance County, as well as for her to be able to get some leadership training and bring that back to our county. And that is, again, that is in Washington, and she'll also be able to attend some of the other training sessions related back to some of the programs that we're looking at, such as our breastfeeding initiative and things like that. So that was for Michelle to go, and you see the total cost of hers is right at $1,500. And
I'm sorry. Please tell them this is our WIC funds.
Absolutely. This is absolutely no county funds involved in this project. These are all.
They're very nice.
And the other request is for Donna Dotson, who's a longtime nutritionist in our department. An opportunity for her to go get some training on specific, really back to neonatal care for our newborn moms, for our high risk infants who are born. This is a conference so that she'll be able to look at how best to assess their nutrition needs, how best to follow those high-risk children after they're born to make sure that we have good outcomes, and also to be able to provide really good services back to the special needs population. And hers was right at it, $1,400.
Same scenario.
Yes, absolutely. These are all state WIC programs, and the state WIC program is amenable for us being allowed to make that expenditure for them to attend these conferences.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. Bass on that?
Just for the sake of information, what kind of money does a WIC person get when they go in? First of all, is it monthly? Is it weekly?
Well, they don't get money.
I mean, I've seen the checks or vouchers.
They get vouchers. Right. The vouchers go specifically.
That's money enough.
Well, what a voucher is, it's like I'll use myself as an example. So if I were to go in, they would do, the nutritionist would do an assessment based on my specific nutritional needs and develop a food program specifically for me based on my nutritional needs, which will say you'll get X amount of whatever products, whether it be cheese or milk or whole grain foods or whatever. So each of those specific food packages that our patient is given is related back to their particular nutritional needs, and they have to have assessments done based, you know, they get like their hematocrit drawn, they get their height, weight, and those kinds of other measures.
So is it weekly, a weekly voucher, or is it a monthly voucher?
I believe they get vouchers. I have to look that up for you.
Okay.
But they are, they have to come in periodically for revisits and all. I won't say because I'm not sure, but I'm thinking it's monthly that they get the vouchers for, or monthly vouchers, but I will get that information back to you.
Yes, well, family of four, a husband, a wife, two children, two small children. What kind of numbers are we looking at here technically? I don't know. I honestly don't know. I know the food stamps, but I don't know the WIC vouchers.
I'd have to go back and look. I'm thinking it's at 185% of federal poverty level. I have to get the numbers.
Can you get some? Give me some. Get
sure,
some figures.
I can have that to you tomorrow morning.
Yeah, I'm just curious. Yeah. Yeah. I've stood behind enough at the grocery stores that have them. I've always kind of wanted to look over the counter, but I can't get that close to them.
Well, you go back to the burden we talked a few minutes ago about the issue of accountability, and the person who is in a grocery store is responsible to make sure that whatever is on that food voucher, that's what that patient receives.
Exactly right. Okay, this is not on here. Do I hear a motion that we allow this travel for the best? Have a
second.
Motion. Second. All in favor?
Okay. Madam Chair, I do have one other thing I do want to mention. I do want to give a big thanks to our EOC, to Dave Leonard and Alva.
I was going
to
do that.
Also to Susan Osborne and Linda Allison and Barry for preparing for the shelters. This was kind of our first opportunity, at least for myself as the county manager, to see our EOC in operation and the coordination that took place and the preparedness that took place through all agencies was very impressive. Yep. We were in very good hands, very well informed, and I just wanted to publicly thank y'all for the work that y'all have done, and hopefully it won't be bad this coming weekend as well. So, but again, thank you guys.
Well, and I want to tell you that I was in touch with Mr. Leonard. I got this, y'all probably don't know about this, it said state of emergency, and I'm like, oh my gosh, and I was the one that had to sign it, you know, and I'm like, well, I didn't know what to do. So I called David Leonard on the phone, and I said, look, you want me to call this right now? And he said, well, no, I don't think you better call this right. This was about 10 o'clock, wasn't it, Dave, on Friday night. And I said, well, you call me anytime during the night. And if you're ready for me to do this, then I had his fax numbers. I was ready to fax it. I just want to tell y'all that I knew what I was doing at that point. So I did have Mr. Leonard's fax numbers, both of them, and his telephone number. And so I said, well, if you get ready for me to do this state of emergency, then I will fax this to you and you get it to the state immediately. So thank you so much, David. And you have our sympathy as well for the loss of your father. I just want to say, father-in-law, thank you so much for doing what you've done. You did a good job on this. So just wanted to tell y'all, I know what to do now. So if we ever need a state of emergency, I got the form. So just let me know when. Okay, the next on our consent agenda. Dave, do you want to talk about the Burlington thing? Or I have read it.
If you need to, yes, ma'am.
If y'all want to talk to Dave about that, it's Burlington wants to come in with us on this
emergency
the hazard mitigation plan. I have read this, and it's just that we have to adopt this. It's in the consent agenda. Does anybody have any questions on that?
No.
Okay. Anybody got any questions on the consent agenda? Anything you want to pull?
I want to pull out. I hate Bill's not here. I want to pull out the community college admissions resolution.
Okay.
8F.
Okay. We will do that.
And
8F.
Yeah, 8F. And just for the sake of respect of their attendance here tonight, if HC, if we can pull out EMS source contract so we can hear the good news there, assuming it's good news. And
which one you want to
And they made it out.
And full HD.
HD is what?
Kathy Holland. Out-of-state track.
Okay, and she is here to, yeah, to tell you about that.
Just take them in order.
I'll say talk to her. We will start with 8C, Mr. Mincillis.
Has it been a year since we've redone that contract?
Yes, sir.
Okay, more time flies.
Especially when you're having fun.
Yes, sir.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, come to you before you tonight. It has been about a week over a year now that we initially had our first renewal of the EMS source contract for our billing and collections of our EMS services. EMS source, based in Greensboro, they have performed very well for us. I think the proof is in the monies that they have collected on our behalf. We went from a meager 36% collections rate when we were doing it in-house to a collection rate of 81.2%. It's what they performed for us in the last fiscal year. Again, the proof is, you know, you hear the cliche, show me the money. They've shown us the money. And it's my opinion that we should renew this contract and let them continue their good work for us. Okay. I'll be glad to answer any questions you might have.
The $5 million that we're projecting that it will be by the end of this fiscal year?
Yes, sir.
What about next year? Is this a continuous flow, or is this back money they were getting, or can you comment on that?
Yes, sir, I can.
Come on
up. We project that you're going to continue to go up, the transports are going to continue to go up, and your collections are going to continue to go up. What we're collecting now is not back money. Okay. This is current billing.
Okay, so you project $5 million next year or better?
Or better.
Okay. I think Chuck alluded to the fact that we only had, $3 million prior to getting into the contract?
$1.2 million.
How much?
$1.2 million for a fiscal year.
I'm sorry?
$1.2 million for a fiscal year.
36%.
Okay, and it's up to $5 million now. What's the biggest improvement area that that you got the money in? Was it EMS emergency calls? Was it in non-emergency? Have you got any breakdown on what was the crux of the increase as far as the money that you were getting? Increased fees?
It was billing correctly, the correct billing. The emergencies were the emergency bills, non-emergency bills. The rate of reimbursement prior to us taking over, they were not necessarily being billed compliant. The compliancy wasn't there. So now we are compliant. We make sure Alamance County is, and I see really that their non-emergency calls and emergency calls are going up, but your reimbursement rate for emergency calls is a higher rate of reimbursement than non-emergency calls.
Does Medicare do a lot of that pay?
Yes, ma'am.
That's what I thought.
Mm-hmm. Medicare and the Medicare HMOs.
Right, HMOs too.
Mm-hmm. And we work, not only do we work with Medicare, the HMOs, we also work with workers' comp and auto insurance as well.
Okay. Any more questions?
Yeah, and what's their percentage? We started off at 10. Are we still at 10 or?
Yes.
Okay.
10%? Yes, sir.
Okay.
Any more questions?
No questions.
Okay, we'll put that back on the consent agenda. Okay, next, we have two back. Next is Ms. Vaughn wants us to pull number.
I just not got it. Pull back because I really don't think that should be hidden in the consent agenda. That I think Ms. Holland needs a lot of accolades and pat on the back for undertaking this, and she graduates this summer. In August. So I say congratulations, Kathy. You're doing a fine job. Thank you. I didn't want it hidden in the consent agenda, so I just wanted to make a point to say this.
And this is for her certification.
Yes.
Okay, her national certification. Okay. So we'll put that back on. All right. Any other questions on the consent agenda?
Yeah, I had 8F.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I hate, Bill's not here. It's my understanding Bill is the one that asked for this to be put on the agenda, and,
I don't know where he is either.
Yeah, I haven't talked to him. And I probably wouldn't have brought it out tonight had I not had a particular situation happen, late last week. It's kind of obvious, you know, it's done, it's a done deal. Of course, they can always reverse it. You know, they've approved this at the state level, when the community college board, state board voted. But what is so ironic about policy like this, I met a person, I'm going to try not to identify anything short of just saying a person. I met a person last week in a business situation, and this person, I heard tell their supervisor that their last day was going to be a certain day at that particular job. And when this person turned to me sort of in private, I asked the person, I said, why is it your last day? And the person said, well, my visa has run out. I've got to go back to my home, my country. And that person's country was in the was in Asia. And this person had been here on a visa, I think, for 5 years. And this person said they were, their visa was up. They didn't want to go back, but they were going to have to go back and reapply, pay $500, which was a lot of money in that country. I said, it's a lot of money in our country. And I asked the person, I said, well, why don't you just apply for citizenship? And the person said that they didn't want to get married, just to become a citizen, that the rules had been changed and that they couldn't apply for citizenship like they once did because of the illegal immigration situation in America and how it's been addressed at the federal level. And I looked at this person and I just shook my head. And you sit back and you see cases of where the police department's writing tickets and just letting people go. Magistrates are just letting people walk out of the office. Community colleges are now wanting to educate if tuition's paid. And you just scratch your head. And I shook the person's hand and I said, thank you for doing it right. Thank you for honoring our laws enough to do it right. And then it just brought up four more situations where I've met two families in Greensboro where they were from Romania and they had to win the lottery to come to America. And these were two teenagers that lived in the same apartment building in Romania and didn't know each other until they got to America, to the high school that they're now at, but didn't know each other in their apartment building in Romania and had to win the lottery. Met another family from one of the Soviet bloc countries where the mother and daughter won a national lottery, the lottery to come to America. And the mother had, she could speak seven languages fluently, but could not come to America short of winning the lottery. And was in Sweden studying when they received notice that they had won. I met another person who was from Central America whose visa had run out, went back to Central America. The person's spouse-to-be came to their country, this other person's country, without trying to say whether it's a he or she, could only stay for 2 years, had to leave the country and come back to America, and they had to go through all the rigmarole, but do it the legal way in order to have this other person come from Central America back to America, and now they're married, and they're in America, and everybody's a U.S. citizen. The point I'm trying to make is here is we had if I'm not mistaken, I could be wrong, but I called Raleigh to the Community College Board when the vote was taken to allow illegal aliens to go to our community colleges. And unless I'm mistaken, and I, with reservations I say this, but I feel like it's got to be said, it's my understanding that we had a former commissioner that sat here who is on the community college system, a board, Sam Powell, and if I owe him an apology, I will apologize. But it's my understanding that he was at that meeting when they voted on illegal aliens attending the community colleges. It was a voice vote. And he voted, or hands were raised, that he voted and that the persons, the people who did not vote for it were clearly identified, and the people at the community college board system told me out of Raleigh said, well, they have to assume that Sam Powell voted for allowing him to attend our community college system. And it's never been even discussed in our community as to why, what was the validity, what he felt like the validity of that vote was. And if he cares to address it, I wish he would publicly.
But it was in the Alman's News several months ago.
It was? Okay, it wasn't in the Times News. Or it was in the, yeah. Well, I don't read your paper every week. So, no, and with all due respect, it wasn't covered as it should have been covered in this community. And it does blow my mind that there are policies out there when you've got people who are doing it the right way versus creating policies to allow those who won't do it the right way, allow them to assemble in our system. And it just blows my mind that these policies exist everywhere you turn. So I'm glad Bill introduced this resolution, and I'm all in favor. I don't think it will do a lot of good, but it might.
It might. We'll try.
Okay. So is that, we can put all this back on the consent agenda now, and do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
Okay.
Have a motion and second. It's all in favor. Be sure and look at your appointment. Oh, thank you. Be sure and look at, yeah, it's the same appointment you had last year. And if you got
I
any.
I think maybe Bill needs a few more, doesn't he?
Him.
Oh, no, Bill.
What?
Bill's not here tonight. Doesn't he get a few more appointments tonight?
Should.
Is there any questions?
Up there.
Are there any questions on this on the appointments? Okay. As you can see, who has the most, by the way.
No, we also see who has the least, by the way.
Anyway, anything else? Any announcements tonight?
It's quality, not quantity.
Do we have any announcements tonight? If not.
I'm sitting on something.
If not, we are adjourned.
Meetings adjourned at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioner's Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 2-7253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.